hills, they go straight up some of the steepest hills I've seen in the world. And when you walk those hills, or drive them even, something sweeps over your body, a rush, a feel, and it's almost like a ripe orange. The poem will just bounce out of your consciousness.
Stephen Kalinich, Stephen John Kalinich. I'm a songwriter and a poet, or I am a human who writes poetry and verse. I was born in upstate New York in Endicott, with where they had EJ shoes. My mother worked even in the shoe factory that had a good medical plan. You felt like someone cared about you, and the companies did seem interested in their workers. Those days are long gone in America, but I wasn't a totally happy child. I didn't amount to much, or I always liked to get attention and like throw a spitball at the kid in front of me or make funny noises. My father was a pro golfer. He taught golf to like Bob Hope, Bing Crosby, Igor Stravinsky, Madame Nu of Japan. And to me, it's very parallel to poetry. A swish, a connect. And a good poem to me, I want to connect with myself and with my audience.
Craft the stillness, cultivate it. As strongly as you embrace words, and miracles will happen within you. For the silence brings a peace no word can ever express, but in rare moments gives a hint of experiencing being alive in the moment. We're in the Casbah Cafe. It is Silver Lake, Echo Park area. It's on Sunset, and I love it here. They have all kinds of coffees, all kinds of tea, all kind of artists. It's like grungier. It's got concrete floors, and it feels like you could really let go and be creative, sink into the cracks. A lot of poets do come to this area. You'll see a lot of computers and a lot of people typing and writing. Some are scripts, some are poems, some are just journals. I feel a life in the streets, even with the wrappers in it and the leaves blowing in. As you look around the cement here, it's ripe for poetry. And yet I go into a hall where people are reading and all the scholars are there, and it seems like death. I guess it depends what kind of poetry you like and what you think poetry is. I'm hoping that I can show you a different kind of poetry, not just the poetry that is written, but the poems that people live, that maybe other people write about, that kind of a poetry. I'm trying to convey, whether I'll be effective or not, I don't know, but I hope I can convey some of it. I love to hear the sound of the city street. I love to go downtown. I love the beat. I walk in the daytime, go to the Central Market. Sometimes I don't take my car. Essay. Are you busy now? Okay. S.A. Griffin is an actor. He's also one of the creators of the Karma Bums, which is a group that went all around the country in their car and did poetry recitations. A really group of great poets.
Bye,
I love you. Bye. Bye.
Los Angeles. Los Angeles.
I mean, I've been called a street poet, a rock poet, a beat poet, a meat poet, a bad poet, a good poet. Everything I write is about Los Angeles, basically, because this is kind of the well I drink from, so to speak. One of the reasons I think Los Angeles is a really great place for poetry is because people don't think we're cool. Even people that live here don't think we're cool. That means we're working even harder. That means we never stop working. At the very core of everything in Los Angeles on the surface is the movie industry. Yeah, it's very competitive. You really are dealing with world-class talent here. I mean, world-class talent. Los Angeles is more like, I make it analogous to a rattlesnake that says, have a nice day. As long as you don't step on it, you're cool, but you step on it, you're going to get bit. And it's very casual. So I'm going to read, There is a river. There is a cheerful ignorance. a chance meeting, and luck like gold that cannot be mined or stolen, a common atom, a dance, and stars that trick the water with their certain magic. Do not wash your wars in it. Take your holy rituals to the precious fountains built by your agencies of fear. Press your wine from the fallout and drink your bitter victory, for yes, there is a river, a giving river that will sing you safely, a river of light, final, fast, and free, where you can disrobe and leave your casual sadness walking sideways at the shore. Meet me there, whoever you are, and we will agree to swim it together.
I like the feeling of America, hitchhiking across it when I did in my early 20s after my father died, seeing all the open spaces, seeing Mount Shasta, and seeing 5 foot of snow on the ground in June in Montana.
This land is your land, and this land is my land, from California.
It was like Woody Guthrie without the music, hitchhiking across the United States to the rhythm of poems.
America, I know you. I feel your open spirit. I roam in your open meadows. I taste the oranges from your orange tree. I smell the blossoms of your pear.
I felt something great here about democracy. With all the problems and all the terrible things going on in the world, you know, Vietnam, I still felt there was something great. And it wasn't the money and the things like nowadays become rich and become successful in that way. It was like I could speak my own mind.
World of peace must come.
These are the streets of LA. You see all the dirt on the street? I love it. Nobody cleans the streets. There's leaves all over. But yet, it looks alive. People are cruising, 99-cent stores all around. And then you have these beautiful mansions. And Los Angeles is a contrast of the beauty and the ugliness and the combination. And sometimes what looks beautiful is death. And sometimes what looks ugly is where the poem can rise.
Bring in all the poets, ride on their verses, walk up and down their words, pick them up out of the gutter. The ones who write with their flesh, with broken steps and gestures, with their lives and suffering that live the poems, with a large swoop, scoop them up in a loose net. Bring in all the poets.
Bring in all the poets.
Bring in all the poets, kiss them, love them passionately, breathe their intensity, ingest it into yourself. Bring in all the poets, those that touch you, those that affect you, those who pound into you, make your heart beat fast.
Yeah, you can walk down the street here and not hear English for like 5 blocks. What do these people, what is their poem? The guy getting a taco at the fish taco stand, the guy carrying the bag, the guy at the car wash there with the vest, you know, hanging down.
Hi, sweetie.
Forgive
this
me,
is
I
Laura.
Just woke up.
It's okay. I know you told me 11 was tough.
Come in.
You told me 11, though.
That dog doesn't stop. My name is Marjorie Light. I go by Gingee when I make music. I'm a DJ, poet. I also organize my own parties and art shows around LA. I'm 29. Within my scene, it's more of the underground scene, I guess. You know, people want to be known, of course. But then there's also the feeling of there's the big industry where people make really big money, and then there's all of us who are kind of struggling on the side, and we're all together, and, you know, we don't really worry about what they do because we're not a part of it anyway, probably, you know. And I kind of started out in the Filipino poetry scene, and then I just got exposed to all these Filipino people and Asian American people who were creating art. I was kind of like an outcast in a way. It took finding other Filipino people that were into art to feel like I was part of this community. I did this poem called Decolonize Your Mind, all about my identity as a Filipino American and just trying to empower myself. Poetry is what it comes down to. Although the shadows of the tall buildings and the stress of the struggle threatens to drown me and surround me with suffering, When I walk these ragged streets with these handmade beats, I stride with the swagger of a traveling minstrel. We live in cycles here and cleanse our soul with belly laughs, hot steam and artistic adventures that push us like toy cars on the Google map of this land. From the deep hand of the valley to the dry riverbed of the northeast, the grid of South Central, into the far west and all the little nooks in between. I travel with my coffee mug imprinted with random donut shop logos. I stop for tacos at little shacks, gas stations where they sell comic books and porn, and stop by the local mega mini mall, stocked full with every variety of every brand. Going back and forth in this Los Angeles dance.
I nearly died. I was in the hospital, emergency surgery. I was getting pains in my chest. They took me in. They discovered I had a blockage in my arteries. In fact, when I was in the hospital with my open heart surgery, a lot of the gang kids would come up to me. They'd say, man, let me see your scar, because it's like 9-10 inches long. And immediately they accepted me like I was cool. I don't think they knew I had a heart surgery. I think they think I got shot or something. I loved those kids. They were great in their energy, and they knew a lot about music.
This is the sound of Venice Beach. There's the skateboarders, the bodybuilders up here. Yeah, you can hear it. Stars and stripes,
made freedom forever. I hate it. I stayed faded, was drunk of raging. All because my pops beat my moms and left us anger. But now I finally see I'm responsible for me. That time is over. Said and done now. If someone's to blame, then I'm the one now. So I style a vista, let it slide like a visa. And let my heart get clean in Jesus' name.
I love the colorful clothes you wear.
Well, I got signed by Brother Records, the Beach Boys. I met a guy in the YMCA when I was staying there for $15 a week. And he played a great 12-string guitar. And we started writing songs. And I wrote a song called Leaves of Grass with Mark.
Leaves of grass,
I made a demo for $15 again. And then the Beach Boys heard that, and they signed me. And I had to go meet them all and recite poems to them. And that was the beginning of my career.
Little bird up in a tree looked down and sang the song to me of how it began.
But some songs that I did that I love are Little Bird with Dennis Wilson, and Be Still with Dennis, and Rainbows with Dennis. I really love those songs.
You know, you know. Be still and know you are. Your life is meant for joy. It's all so deep within. Oh.
I didn't get a 50-50 deal. I got less because I didn't know. I had no one representing me.
This is where the Beach Boys office used to be. Up on the right, Ivar and Sunset. It was quite a place. It's gotten uglier though, hasn't it? Yeah, and commercialized. As Tarzan said in one of the old movies, flying over New York City for the first time. Stone Jungle.
I had an album that I had done some tracks on called A World of Peace Must Come. And I brought it to Brian Wilson.
Hi, Steve.
He loved it. He said, let's do an album, like a home recording. We wanted A World of Peace, Brian and I, and this was our way of doing it.
Do you want me to play some organ on it? Do you want I'll play some more.
Be still and know you are. Be still and listen to your heartbeat. Feel it pumping blood and energy and life into every cell in your body. Know that your life is meant for joy. That you are meant to grow sturdy like the tall oak tree. Know that like the flower takes the sun and wind and rain and eventually blossoms, your life too must go through many changes. You must take in many thoughts and much experience before you blossom.
And then it took us 20 years to get a release, which was in 2000 and something, and went out all over the world.
All life, from the tiny one-cell life to the unimaginable life of the galaxies and planets.
We're on Venice Boulevard. We're going toward P.F. Sloan's house. At 19 years old, he had a number one record in 1965 called Eve of Destruction, and Barry McGuire sang it. But he's also a very spiritual person. I went to India with him and John Tiven. I think I've probably been more influenced by him than Bob Dylan, but he is really a poet, even though he's a famous songwriter.
Hey, look at the, you're getting some oranges, huh?
Looks like, yeah. They're sweet. I had one simple goal, and that was I could lay on my pillow at night before I die and be able to run through in my mind the poetry that I had composed and let it be enough so that my soul is at peace. And that took 20 years. The simplest of the simple is what it's about. I don't know if Steve told you, but L.A. in the 60s was like Paris in the 20s. The gravity was so much less than it is now, you'd never recognize it. The light that was shining in here, you wouldn't recognize it now. It was when all artistry broke free and clear and loose. LA always had a counterfeit nature to it. You know when you go to a party and there's some plastic fruit and you're hungry and you don't understand why they have plastic fruit? L.A. was like that. To be in a place that was so plastic actually worked for you. While you were struggling against the phony nature of celebrity and Hollywood, and while you were struggling against that sandpaper, you were being rubbed smooth to do the ultimate best work that you could do, to prove your soul's worth.
Streets are dark, and shadows lonely. Life feels cold and so unfriendly.
I've basically spent my early youth with all the greats in the music business. And in the end, it wasn't ever for me about the money, and it wasn't ever to me about the name value, because all that went, all that disappeared. I had to give it all away. It was the opportunity to express your soul. Beethoven was the missing key for me as the insight into myself, spiritually, poetry, and music. Can I read you something? I'll give you an example. Okay, this is the play. It's called Louis Louis because Ludwig was called Louis by the French. Beethoven is at his desk. He's pouring himself a cognac and begins to speak. Today, a strange woman at my door says she liked my tune. It feels like I've been working for 100 hours, but it's only 1 p.m. Where did the morning go so soon? The wind is bending low the bowers. A blackened sky hides the sun and moon. The joy of life escapes me, till a woman at my door said she liked my tune. Some strange woman at my door said she likes my tune.
We're on right now. We're on Highland, heading up towards Sunset Boulevard. Yeah, Hollywood. There's not a lot of softness in the town. There's a harshness to the driving. People cut people off. They seem to be all in their own worlds. This is the Hollywood photography studio where a lot of the people get their headshots. The thing is, you got to realize millions of people, thousands, hundreds, come to this town to make it, and only a small handful get a glimpse of it. And even when you get it, it doesn't deliver what it says it's going to deliver. You want it more than God, more than money, more than love. You want to dance like the J-Men and wear the white glove in the fame game. The fame game. The world watches as closely as you. They want to know what those on the big screen do, where they eat, who they sleep with, how much they're worth. They want to get inside their mind and dig up all the dirt in the fame game. Prostitutes, pimps, broken down winos, sleep under billboard, white like albinos, muted, jaded, no piece of the dream. American casualties scream, ah! You want it more than God, more than money, more than love. You want to dance like the J-Men, wear the white glove in the fame game. The fame game. The shift I feel in society is, I think it's grown deeper into materialism.
or it's less buried and more on the surface. It could be terrible, the world's getting worse, or it could be that it's getting better, because when it rises to the top, we can do something about it. We can stand up and fight against it. So the love and peace thing, my thing is, it didn't exactly work that way. And the reality is, we have to be active in our own lives in bringing a peace.
The World Trade Center event wasn't much unlike the dropping of the atomic bomb or something. It redefined ourselves.
I say Griffin.
I just had this really strong desire to get a bomb and put poetry in it. It took me years to find a bomb because, and again, in a post-911 world, you just can't find a bomb anymore. You know, most of the hippies, they farmed the deserts and stole all those bombs a long time ago. Because it was really, you know, back in the hippie days, oh yeah, look, it's a bomb, it's cool, we'll turn it into a giant ashtray or something. Break on through to the other side. Break on through. So I went on and I dropped the word bomb into the search engine. And the first hit was this guy who had a bomb for sale for $100. It was from 1970, Vietnam era. And sometimes they do have explosive materials in them. I guess this one didn't. And this one is all bent and, you know, dented, which is exactly what I wanted. And there's about 900 poems in there from all over the world, representatives of wars from every major American conflict from World War I to the present. I did a tour around the entire United States for 5 weeks. And so that was really the whole purpose of the poetry bomb, using poetry as a vehicle to tell people we must learn to communicate, we must learn to disagree with one another in a very civil manner, or everything that we understand and know is gone. So if they ever name the streets, they will name them love, for the children they never bore, for the city built without eyes, because there is always more than the concrete, the asphalt, the cars parked by exhausted meters, the pedestrians.
I would like people to hear Ellen Maybe, because it's a good poem that captures why you want to be an artist and why you want to be an artist in Los Angeles.
Being an artist means the recession will always be there and has always been here while you sit not writing screenplays, not taking meetings, just writing love letters to Van Gogh's beard, not wearing a watch, not caring who's on the cover of People magazine. Being an artist means you might sleep awfully late. You might choose totally different things as the four major food groups. Being an artist means you probably memorize the aisles at the 99-cent store. Being an artist means you don't feel you have the right to remain silent. Being an artist means people think your closet is full of turtlenecks and mood rings. People assume you play harmonica. People assume you know all the words to every song released in the 1960s. Being an artist means you do. Being an artist is an active verb, a noun, a consonant, an adjective in a world full of chaotic life sentences. Being an artist is not necessarily a choice.
The daily work that I'm doing as a poet, 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, 1 in the morning, I write a poem.
5 a.m. in America, I just can't get to sleep.
And then I send it to my partner in Nashville, and he tries to put a melody to it. I've written, with John Tiven, 700 to 800 songs.
It takes time to heal a broken heart.
You believe that? Instead of 99, they had to go down to 98 cent store here. They're trying to get a new angle instead of the 99 cent store. It's like 7 minute abs. It'll be down to 5 minute abs like that movie.
Every servant is a master. Every child
is a man on his way to something, always leaving someone, always coming home and leaving, returning to a house.
Look at Malibu, look how beautiful the ocean is. Do you feel poetic, musical? I wanted to feel the colors of Los Angeles and become part of the fabric. It's like a quilt, a living quilt. The emotions and the colors, the sounds. I think LA taught me when I saw the people trying to be famous and trying to be rich and all the things, and trying to even draw attention to myself as a poet, that the real poems came the more I just lived and let something come out.
LA, with all its craziness, drinking whiskey and doing all the crazy things that I did and running around and in the Rolls Royces and having fun and hitting rock bottom and working in gas stations, LA experience, it gave me so much. I'm 71, almost 72 now, but I still love life. I feel like a kid, although my body may not always act it, and I still feel hope. Now, is that crazy? Is that delusional? I don't think so. Some moments, only the silence rings true. Sometimes I do not want to hear a human voice. The silence is the greatest poem.